हेलो, गुड इवनिंग। हेलो गणेश जी। हाय अंशुल। हाय गौरव। ओके। हाय गौरव। गुड इवनिंग। गुड इवनिंग। ओके। सो आई वॉज जस्ट चेकिंग आउट द अदर लाइव्स दैट वर गोइंग ऑन एंड आई रियलाइज दैट माई टॉपिक ऑफ पार्टीशन इज क्वाइट अ डिफरेंट वन। वेरी फ्यू पीपल हैव डेल्ट विद एनी टॉपिक्स ऑफ हिस्ट्री इन दैट। सो एंड इवन द टॉपिक दैट वी आर टॉकिंग ऑफ इज द पार्टीशन ऑफ इंडिया। So till date we have seen partition as a more of an emotional issue because it's very connected to us because it was about our past, but very few times we have actually seen partition as a historical process, and that is the reason, that is the purpose of this live. Many a times we study partition till 10th standard in our history textbooks and everything, but we generally don't read about it later on. But a curiosity exists in our mind as to really what partition is, what led to partition, what events had happened, and we don't really get a concise source to read about it. That is the reason why this live has been conducted, to tell you about exactly what partition was and how partition happened. In history, it's actually the process, especially events like partition. They are so huge in their entire aspect that it is very difficult to pin down the blame on one event or one individual कि इसकी वजह से सब कुछ हुआ। इट्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू से दैट। नॉर्मली इवेंट्स आर मल्टीपल। इन हिस्ट्री इट्स अबाउट कॉज एंड इफेक्ट फिनोमिनन। द कॉज एंड इफेक्ट फिनोमिनन इज दैट देर आर टेन्स ऑफ कॉजेस विच आर फंक्शनिंग इंडिपेंडेंटली एंड ऑल देम कम टुगेदर टू फॉर्म वन इफेक्ट एंड दैट इफेक्ट बिकम्स अ कॉज फॉर सम फर्दर इफेक्ट। सो दैट इज हाउ दैट चेन रिएक्शन गोज ऑन ऑफ कॉज इफेक्ट कॉज एंड इफेक्ट। सो इन पार्टीशन वील एक्चुअली बी सीइंग मल्टीपल स्टेक होल्डर्स, द ब्रिटिश, द कांग्रेस इंक्लूडिंग गांधी, द हिंदू महासभा एंड ऑफकोर्स द मुस्लिम लीग, एंड देन वॉट वर द व्यूज ऑफ अदर पीपल लाइक बाबा साहेब अम्बेडकर ऑल्सो। एंड वील एक्चुअली सी हाउ द इवेंट स्लोली स्लोली ट्रांसपायर्ड एंड फाइनली लेड टू द पार्टीशन ऑफ इंडिया। नाउ इफ आई एम टू आस्क अ क्वेश्चन, से 1920 और से 1925, डिड एनीबडी इमेजिन दैट इंडिया वुड बी पार्टीशन? द आंसर इज नो। नो बडी थॉट दैट इंडिया कुड एक्चुअली बी पार्टीशन देन। सो दिस वी कैरी दिस मिसकॉन्सेप्शन इन आर माइंड दैट सिंस डे वन, वेन एवर मुस्लिम मास मोबिलाइजेशन स्टार्टेड, सिंस डे वन दे स्टार्टेड आस्किंग फॉर अ सेपरेट कंट्री। वेल दैट्स नॉट रियली ट्रू। सो वी विल सी दैट डिमांड ऑल्सो डेवलप थ्रू द एजेस। इट हैड वेरियस ट्रिगर्स ऑफ इट्स ओन। मल्टीपल इवेंट्स विद इन इंडिया एंड आउटसाइड इंडिया वर हैपनिंग विच एक्चुअली लेड टू द प्रोसेस ऑफ पार्टीशन ऑफ इंडिया। सो बिफोर आई बिगिन आई वॉन्टेड टू गिव यू अ लिटिल बिट ऑफ हेड्स अप ऑफ वॉट एग्जैक्टली ब्रिटिश इंडिया वॉज, बिकॉज बिफोर नोइंग दैट, विदाउट नोइंग दैट, इट्स इट वी वोंट अंडरस्टैंड द सब्जेक्ट। यू अंडरस्टैंड दिस दैट इन ब्रिटिश इंडिया वी हैड थ्री लेवल्स ऑफ गवर्नमेंट। ब्रिटिश इंट्रोड्यूस थ्री लेवल्स ऑफ गवर्नमेंट इन इंडिया। एट द लोकल लेवल वी हैड म्युनिसिपल बोर्ड्स, डिस्ट्रिक्ट बॉडीज, यूनिवर्सिटीज एक्सेट्रा। दीज पीपल इनडायरेक्टली इलेक्टेड द पीपल टू द प्रोविंशियल लेजिस्लेचर। सो देर वर 11 प्रोविंसेस इन इंडिया, बॉम्बे, मद्रास, बंगाल, आसाम, उड़ीसा, यूनाइटेड प्रोविंस, पंजाब, सिंध, नॉर्थ वेस्ट फ्रंटियर प्रोविंस। दीज वर 11 प्रोविंसेज इन इंडिया एंड देयर लेजिस्लेटिव असेंबलीज यूज टू बी इनडायरेक्टली इलेक्टेड, एंड फ्रॉम देयर इनडायरेक्ट इलेक्शन यूज टू बी हेल्ड, एंड द सेंट्रल लेजिस्लेटिव असेंबली एट द कैपिटल डेली दैट यूज टू गेट इलेक्टेड। सो दैट यूज टू बी द थ्री स्टेज ऑफ गवर्नमेंट दैट वी हैड। सिंस वी आर टॉकिंग ऑफ मुस्लिम डिमांड फॉर अ सेपरेट कंट्री, द पॉलिटिकल प्रोसेस इज इम्पॉर्टेंट। दैट इज द रीजन वाई आई एम एक्सप्लेनिंग दिस टू यू। सो 1892 एंड 1909, दीज आर द टू ईयर्स वेन एक्चुअली द ब्रिटिश हैड पास्ड कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल रिफॉर्म्स एंड देयर दे हैड इंट्रोड्यूस दिस थ्री लेवल्स ऑफ गवर्नमेंट एंड दिस प्रोसेस ऑफ इनडायरेक्ट इलेक्शन। सो इंडियंस कुड गेट पॉलिटिकल रिप्रेजेंटेशन इन देयर ओन कंट्री, इवन दो नॉट इन मेजोरिटी, बट सम इंडियंस कुड गेट इलेक्टेड। इन 1919, सो फ्रॉम 1892 1909, Till 1919, they introduced direct elections at the provincial level. So people in the provinces could directly vote and elect their Indian representatives at the provincial level. Furthermore, reforms were happening in 1935 Act, where they have more reforms. So these years are important. I'll keep repeating these years as when we talk. So 1892, 1909, 1919, 1935. These are the most important years. So this is the basic heads up that I wanted to give before we really start. So if I have to deal with the issue of partition, I'll rather deal with it in three phases, three, four phases. The first phase I categorize is till 1920. 1920 is because that is the phase when Khilafat movement started in 1920. So we have heard of non-cooperation movement of Gandhiji, and combined with it was the Khilafat movement. So till 1920, I'll categorize that phase as early beginning. Like the British were slowly, slowly trying to appease the Muslims, and it was just an early beginning. From 1920 to 1937, I'll call that time as more of a political compromise time. So where the Muslim League is trying to extract maximum political benefits from the British. That is the second phase that we will be dealing with. From 1935-37 onwards till about 1946, that is the period of obstructionism, where the demand for Pakistan actually comes up and Muslim League stonewalls every kind of talks that the British are having with any Indian entity for further process of independence. And after 1946, it is out and out violence. So the absolute violence for the sake of partition, that will, if you could not listen to us by negotiations, now we'll simply kill people to get a separate country. So these are the roughly four phases that we will be dealing with. If I have to start with the first phase, now Muslims as a separate entity was never really seen. We had early traces of Sir Syed Ahmad Khan. He was the establisher of Aligarh Muslim University. He in the 1880s had said that Hindus and Muslims are two separate nations, and that is considered to be the start of the two-nation theory. But not really we have any major event of Muslim mobilization till the early 1900s. The reason why Muslims mobilized was also very peculiar. Please understand the process. Now, if you look at the Hindus, they were ahead socially because they had multiple social reforms. They were ahead educationally because they sent their children to English education. Naturally, they had maximum representation in government jobs because they had modern education. They were ahead economically because all the major Indian businessmen, zamindars, landowners, everybody were Hindus. So Muslims could not compete with Hindus in any of these fields. The only one field in which finally they felt like, okay, we should have some competition is the political field, because there was no scope of competing with Hindus in social, educational, or economic fronts. So the only the competition with the Hindus should be at the political front. That is the reason why you will find that Muslim mobilization started to extract maximum benefits from the British. Because I told you, British introduced the system of indirect elections at three levels, at local level, at provincial level, and at the federal level or central level. So naturally, the Muslims said that we cannot have any competition with Hindus in any other field. So at least let us have maximum political representation. Let's extract maximum benefits from the British as much as we can, because that is the only source of keeping Muslims relevant in India. Because in those days, India was about 60-65% Hindus, about 30% Muslims. So naturally, if the free and fair elections were held, naturally the Muslims could never gain a big majority, because this was a Hindu majority country. So the entire process of Muslim mobilization started with this fact that Muslims need separate representation or some basic political support for them to realize their so-called aspirations. And naturally, the British supported it because all the major revolutionaries were Hindus. So they did not want the Hindu community to become too big. Naturally, you will find that it was the British who started to prop up Muslims to as a counter or as a buffer to the Hindus. It was the British policy to ensure that you should use Muslims against the Hindus just to keep the revolutionary spirit among the Hindus under control. So what happened was that after the partition of Bengal happened in 1905, we might have heard about Swadeshi movement in Bengal. I will not go into the details of it, but the British finally felt that it is time for Hindus to be divided and Muslims to be pitched against them. You will find that the Muslim League for the first time was set up in 1906, in 1907. That was because there was a delegation of Muslims led by the Nawab of Dhaka, and Aga Khan that went to meet the then Viceroy Lord Minto, and there they said that we need separate representation for Muslims because now you will have constitutional reforms in 1909, so we are aware of it, so we want some extra benefits for Muslims in that. And to pursue that aim further, they set up the Muslim League, the All India Muslim League in 1907 at Dhaka. You will find that the Muslim League was essentially pro-British. Its early policies were not apparently mass mobilize karo, kill Hindus or ask for a separate country, nothing of that sort. Their early aims were somehow to ensure that we had more representation for Muslims in political sphere. Naturally, the British also wanted the same thing. So what happened was that in 1909, the Government of India Act 1909 was passed, which had introduced this process of indirect elections. There, for the first time, the British introduced the concept of a separate electorate for Muslims. What does it mean? Today in India, we have reserved electorates for SCs and STs. It means that from that constituency for Lok Sabha, on the candidate who will fight will only be SC or ST. But everybody residing in that constituency can vote, whether you are open category, SC, ST or Muslim or any person. What is a separate electorate? A separate electorate is that in that constituency, the candidate will of course be a Muslim, but the people who are eligible to vote for that candidate will also be Muslims. So it's as if like the Hindus of that constituency are disenfranchised. You have no right to vote. So you will find that separate electorates for Muslims were given in 1909. That was the first where what can we say the ball was set rolling for separatism amongst Muslims in 1909. Lord Minto himself, when he passed that 1909 act, he said that we have sown dragon's teeth and the harvest is going to be bitter. So that was his comment, that this is not something that should have happened and the harvest is going to be bitter. And he was quite a visionary. We saw the bitter harvest in 1947. So that was the start. Naturally, the Congress opposed it. All the major national leaders opposed it. They said, no, we will not have separate electorates based on religion. You are trying to divide Indians, etc., etc. Nothing happened. You will find that the Congress itself was in a disarray. And by 1914, when the World War I started, you will find that there was a renewed vigor amongst the Congressees that we should again regroup together, bring all the political entities in India together and now set up a renewed fight against the British. And in pursuance of that, in 1916, there was a Congress session. Congress, after it was set up in 1885, every December of every year, it will have a session, an annual session of All India Congress Committee, AICC. So you will find that every December of every year, alag alag places in India where you will have Congress session. So in 1916, the Congress session was scheduled at Lucknow. It is popularly known as the Lucknow session. The Muslim League was invited for that session. These are considered to be the biggest blunders of Tuck, Annie Besant and all the other leaders. The Muslim League was invited, and just for garnering the support of Muslim League for more and more constitutional reforms, because 1909 Act had been passed, the trend was that every 10 years the British will review and give more and more reforms for India. So the next act was scheduled for 1919. So they wanted that Indians should come together and put up a unified demand that we want more representation in the legislatures at the central and the provincial level, and we want more executive powers, because till that time they were only MPs. They had no executive power. So they said that hame executive power bhi chahiye. So that reform ke liye you need a united front. And that is why in 1916, the Congress invited the Muslim League for the Lucknow session. And in that Lucknow session, the Congress accepted separate electorates. So in 1909, when the Congress was dead against separate electorates, in 1916, the Congress accepted the principle of separate electorates. The biggest blunder from the side of the Congress was that it legitimized Muslim separatism. And the Muslim League decided that, okay, since you have accepted our demand, we will also support the Congress agenda of having more and more reforms in the 1919 Act, which was going to be passed. And the act was passed. In 1919, the act was passed. The concept of separate electorates continued. And the biggest reform of 1919 Act was that it allowed direct elections. So till 1909, it was indirectly elected. So the people at municipal boards, they used to elect among themselves and send their representatives to the province. From the provincial legislatures, they used to elect among themselves and send their representative to the central legislature. For the first time in 1919 Act, direct elections were accepted at the provincial level. So if say we are residing in the Bombay province, we are citizens of the Bombay province, we can, if we are allowed to vote, we can actually directly vote and elect Indian representatives to that provincial legislature, to all the 10-11 provinces that had existed then. So direct elections were introduced with the principle of separate electorate. So there were separate constituencies reserved for Muslims. So that was the real start of political representation of Muslims in various legislatures. Now, as we say, when the tiger tastes the blood, it will always want more. What happened was that the World War I, from 1914, it ended in 1918. The Allied powers, that is Britain and Russia and all these powers, these were essentially fighting against Germany, Austria, Italy, and the Ottoman Empire, that is Turkey, today's Turkey, with their capital at Constantinople. Now, this Ottoman Empire's head was the Khalifa, or the highest political head of the Muslims. And naturally, when Britain defeated Turkey, they unseated the Khalifa. They captured all the Middle Eastern regions, Iraq, Jordan, Saudi Arabia, Syria, Lebanon, all these important Muslim areas, including Makkah and Medina, and the seat of the Khalifa at Constantinople. They were captured by the British and the French, and they unseated the Khalifa. This resulted in a totally new process amongst Muslims throughout the world, that is called as the Khilafat, or the urge to for restoration of that Khalifa, because he is the supreme political leader of Muslims throughout the world. So even if the Muslims live in any country, for them their political leader is the Khalifa and not the head of that particular country. So what happened is, after 1918, this process, you will find that the entire problem started to snowball, and Muslims from India started to be mobilized with the help of Muslims from outside. And you will find that the entire problem began in India, that now the Muslims began mobilizing, but for a demand which was not Indian. The demand was a foreign demand of Khalifa, for reinstating that Khalifa in Constantinople. So till 1920, you will find that it was a general start of Muslim mobilization. British had given them separate electorates, Congress accepted it, and the process of separatism amongst Muslims was snowballed. You will naturally find that in 1915, as a response to the Muslim League, it was felt that there should be a separate organization for the Hindus, and that's why in 1915, you have the Hindu Mahasabha being set up by the Maharaja of Kasim Bazar. So in 1915, you have Hindu Mahasabha set up as an exclusive organization to preserve the Hindu interests as a pure reaction to the Muslim League. So you will find that till 1920, when the Tyak era was generally going on, the Congress was more of a Hindu body only, because there were very few Muslim leaders, and the Congress always used to take up the issues of Hindus generally. So you will find that there was no need for a separate Hindu body. But after the entry of Gandhi in 1917, roughly is where Gandhi will, you will find him on the political front. When Mahatma Gandhi started to be politically active after 1917, his rhetoric of a Hindu-Muslim unity actually made Congress to come into a sort of a centric position, that it is no more tilting towards the Hindus, but it was now espousing the Hindu-Muslim unity. And that was Gandhi who was the proponent, that at any cost, this country will progress only if there is Hindu-Muslim unity. We will see ahead how this entire false illusion of Hindu-Muslim unity just came crashing down as we come to the 1940s ka decade. So you will find that till 1920, there was just primary movement towards this Muslim separatism. When we go after 1920, I call it as the period of extracting maximum concessions from the British. Because now you will find that the Muslims have mobilized, and now they want more and more and more powers from the British, and they want the Congress also to accept it, that you should give us more and more and more freedom, more powers in political field. So I told you that in 1920, the entire Khilafat movement happened, coupled with the non-cooperation movement, which was again considered to be the biggest blunder of Gandhi, because he wanted, or he tried to get Muslim support for a national cause by giving them support for a cause which was not even Indian. Because Khalifa was sitting in Constantinople, he was not to come to India at any cost. So this set up a different process altogether, that if you really want Muslims to support a national cause, you should essentially give them some concessions. So their support is not unconditional. They will give you support only when you accept some demands of theirs. So this mentality that, you know, you will be given concessions after concessions, only then we'll get your support. This mentality continued till 1947, and the end result was a separate country. So this process was started by Gandhi at a mass level after 1920, is when the Khilafat movement started. Now, naturally, the Muslim League had blood on its mouth, so it wanted more. So it said that now we want more and more powers, because the next revision of the act was going to be in 1929, the next constitutional reforms. So they said that we want informal arrangements with the Congress and at multiple provincial levels, where we want to extract maximum benefits. So you have heard the name of this person called Chittaranjan Das. He was a big Congress leader from Bengal. The Muslim League tried to negotiate with Chittaranjan Das in 1923 and for the province of Bengal, where they wanted that Muslims should be given more representation. Because why Bengal? Because Bengal was a Muslim majority province. Muslims were about 55% in Bengal. So you will find that whatever processes, political concessions that the Muslims will ask henceforth till 1947, they will be centered around all the Muslim majority regions like Punjab, Bengal, Assam, Sindh, Northwest Frontier Province. That these are the regions where now the Muslim League will ask for more and more concessions at the provincial level, because they are numerically higher than, they are Muslim majority provinces. So this process started with Bengal, that Chittaranjan Das negotiated a so-called deal with the Muslim League. It was called as the Bengal Pact, and the demands were very peculiar, that Muslims will be given more seats in the provincial assembly of Bengal. They will be given more representation in, say, the civil services. They will have better say in what laws will be passed. So if, like, unless a majority of Muslim members of that assembly want that law to be passed, only then it will be passed. If they object it, you cannot pass the law even if you have majority. So these are the kind of concessions that the Muslim League now started demanding. So this is next stage now. Till that, they were only like, hame separate electorate though. Now they are like, okay, now we want more and more concessions. The Bengal Pact of 1923 was rejected by the Congress. The other Congress, in the Congress session, when this Bengal Pact was put to vote, it was rejected out and out by the Congress. And this led to many Muslim leaders being estranged. Now they got very angry that how come you are not fulfilling our demands? At this stage, you will find that Muhammad Ali Jinnah was not present. He became active after 1930s, because he was dead opposed to this entire non-cooperation Khilafat thing. So he had resigned from the Muslim League, etc., etc. You have Muslim leaders like Muhammad Ali, Shaukat Ali, and many Deobandi and Barelvi sect Maulanas, who were actually spearheading this Muslim movement. And they got very upset with this, that how can the Congress reject our demand for this more political concessions? So in the 1920s, you will generally find that these people, these Muslim leaders, have now started to make contrary statements to the Congress. They have called it that their Congress is like an adjunct body of the Hindu Mahasabha. The Congress is just a body of Hindus. It never represents the Muslims, and the Congress will always act against the Muslims. That kind of a propaganda began to be propagated by the Muslim League. It was added by the fact that in 1920s, it was a horrendous decade, because there was tremendous communal violence that took place. In the especially after 1922 till 1927, these were the years when a lot of violence took place in United Provinces, that is today's Uttar Pradesh. Violence took place in Punjab. You have a prominent Arya Samaji leader, Swami Shraddhanand. He was shot dead. And so you will find that Muslims now suddenly are mobilized for violence, extreme violence. And the same has been reciprocated by the Hindus. So you have violence breaking out because there is Navratri, and how did you not allow our Durga Puja? A music procession went outside the masjid. They started throwing stones and started beating people. A Muslim shopkeeper got into an argument with a Hindu customer, and violence started. So you will find that all the ridiculous reasons are now being used for setting up violence, and cities after cities started to record violence. So in all of these 1920s decade, it was more of a very unsettling decade. And it is not that this unsettling did not stop. It did not stop till 1947. यहाँ से जो कम्युनल वायलेंस चालू हुआ एट स्मॉल स्मॉल लोकेशंस, स्लोली स्लोली इट इंक्रीज टू सच अ लेवल दैट बाय 1946 यू एक्चुअली हैड द थ्रेट दैट दिस कंट्री मे बी गोइंग इन टू अ सिविल वॉर. सो वील गो टू दैट लेटर. सो यू विल फाइंड दैट बाय 1920s अ लॉट ऑफ वायलेंस वॉज गोइंग ऑन इन इंडिया. एंड वॉट वॉज द कांग्रेस डूइंग? इट वॉज अंडर गांधी एंड इट गांधी वॉज प्रोपोगेटिंग हिंदू मुस्लिम यूनिटी. सो फॉर देम हिंदू मुस्लिम यूनिटी इज द फॉरमोस्ट प्रोपोगेंडा दैट it's like you have created your own utopian dreamland where you believe that Hindu Muslim unity exists and you believe that only that can take the country ahead. But if you look at on ground, there is too much violence and the Congress did nothing to quell that violence. So here, from 1920s itself, you will find that this entire theory of Gandhi of Hindu Muslim unity was actually failing, and he refused to open his eyes. And when he opened his eyes in 1940s, it was too late. You had no choice but to give a separate country. So you will find that a lot of violence took place. When did the entire thing again come back to political concessions? It was in 1927. Why? Because the Simon Commission came to India. We all have heard this, Simon go back, Simon go back. What was that commission? That commission, since in 1929, we had the next constitutional reforms due. You had in 1927 the Simon Commission coming to India for talking to various sections of Indian society about what demands they have, what are the constitutional reforms that you want. And naturally, there was no Indian in that body, so the Congress boycotted it. But the Muslim League participated in it, Ambedkar participated in it, because Ambedkar was wanting separate electorates for the depressed classes. But the Muslim League participated in it very well, given the fact that the entire country was angry. Lala Lajpat Rai was killed, Bhagat Singh and all these aides were doing their revolutionary activities. You had the Congress saying openly that now we want Purna Swaraj or total independence in 1929. Despite all of these activities against the British, the Muslim League under Jinnah, he was the one who went and now he started talking on behalf of the Muslim League to the British, to the Simon Commission. Simon Commission asked him, what are the demands? What do you want? Jinnah had compiled 14 demands. They are called as the Delhi proposals. You can read up anywhere on the internet. They are called as the Delhi proposals. These proposals were submitted to Lord Simon. And naturally, the follow-up was done with the Viceroy of those times, Lord Irwin. What were these demands? Now just see. From separate electorates, now just see where they have graduated to. What are they asking now? Jinnah is asking that we want extreme federalism, as in the central government should not have much powers on the provinces. Why? Because then the Muslim League will be free to run the Muslim majority provinces of Punjab, Bengal, Northwest Frontier Province, etc. So there should be federal principles apart from defense and foreign policy and all these things. The rest all should be left to the provinces because they will get more power. The second demand was that the Muslims wanted 1/3 representation at the central legislature. So 1/3 representation, because they felt that if India is a Hindu majority country, Muslims can never get elected. So they want 1/3 reservation at the central legislature. So separate electorates are just not enough now. Now want 1/3 seats in the central legislature. At the provincial level, they say that wherever Muslims are in majority, they want reservation as a percentage of population. So in Bengal, if they are 55%, Muslims should have 55% seats for them, essentially meaning they get a majority. Same for Punjab, same for other parts where there was Muslim majority. So see how smart they are. Where they are in minority at the central level, they want 1/3 reservation. And when they are in the provinces where they are in majority, they want representation based on population. So essentially they say that aapko federalism chahiye so that provinces will get more power. And in the Muslim majority provinces, you will have reservation based on population. So the implication is that the Muslim League will get total control over Punjab, Bengal and other Muslim majority regions. So you will see how they are cleverly playing with the British, that these are the constitutional reforms that we want so that we get more provincial autonomy. What was the next demand? What if we could carve out new provinces which are Muslim majority? So they said that a new province called Sindh should be created. Sindh, that is a Karachi and the entire region, was a part of Bombay province. So Bombay, that is Western Maharashtra, Konkan, Bombay city, Gujarat and Sindh, all these together constituted the Bombay province. बट सिंध बींग अ मुस्लिम मेजोरिटी रीजन वॉज नेवर रिप्रेजेंटेड प्रॉपरली बिकॉज गुजरात एंड महाराष्ट्र वर इसेंशियली हिंदू मेजोरिटी रीजन्स. सो नाउ द नेक्स्ट डिमांड वॉज इन फ्रंट ऑफ लॉर्ड साइमन दैट सिंध शुड बी क्रिएटेड एज अ सेपरेट प्रोविंस विद इट्स कैपिटल इन कराची. वाई? बिकॉज इट्स अ मुस्लिम मेजोरिटी प्रोविंस, सो मुस्लिम लीग हैज बेटर चांसेज ऑफ विनिंग देयर. सिमिलरली नॉर्थ वेस्ट फ्रंटियर प्रोविंस वॉज आस्क्ड टू बी कार्व्ड आउट. टिल दैट टाइम इट वॉज सॉर्ट ऑफ अ यूनियन टेरिटरी बिकॉज इट वॉज अ बाउंड्री प्रोविंस, बिकॉज ऑन द अदर साइड इट वॉज अफगानिस्तान एंड रशिया वॉज ऑल्सो क्वाइट क्लोज बाय. सो यू कुड एक्चुअली देर वॉज अ फियर दैट USSR could invade from northwestern part of India through Afghanistan. So British never wanted democracy to come in northwest frontier province. But Jinnah said that create a separate province of northwest frontier province because that was also almost more than 90% Muslim majority. So the demand was clear that we want more representation by hook or by crook. And these were the smart demands that were put forth by them. So you understand, see how the process is going. From the early demand that we want separate electorates, now they are asking for separate provinces, autonomy to those provinces, reservation in those provinces. So the demands are now increasing slowly, slowly, that okay, now this is what they are asking. Naturally, the Congress steadfastly opposed it. It is not that despite the Hindu-Muslim rhetoric, the Congress was not aware. It did oppose it. All the big leaders, including Gandhi, Nehru, Bose, Patel, everybody opposed it. They said that no, this is not a demand that we should be fulfilling. But doesn't matter. In 1930, you had the civil disobedience movement, but the Muslim demands were never fulfilled till that time. So you will find that Muslims did not much participate in the civil disobedience movement. So what the British did, they said that, okay, bhai, theek hai, we will have round table conferences in London. So rather than asking a Simon Commission to come to India, we'll summon the representatives of Indian political parties to London and have round table conferences. There were three round table conferences, 1931 mein do hue and 1932 mein ek hua. But the problem was that the Congress boycotted first and the third conference. It was only in the second conference that you have the Congress representing. Gandhi himself had gone there. But the Muslim League had representation in all the three. The debate was that should the demands of Muslim Leagues be fulfilled? Ambedkar was asking for separate electorates for Dalits, that is depressed classes. And the princely states, which were not actually a part of these provinces, the 560 princely states, they were asking for a federal, more powers for them. It's called as the All India Federation, but we'll not go into that. But you understand, different stakeholders of India at that point of time were going to Britain and putting forth their demands. The British, as usual, accepted the demands of Jinnah or the Muslim League. So the act of 1929, which was to be passed ideally after 10 years, because of the civil disobedience movement and the round table conference, the act got quite late and it was passed in 1935. We call it as the Government of India Act 1935. It accepted that, okay, we should have hold provincial elections at provinces with the concept of direct elections. Indians can form governments in provinces, all the 11 provinces. And they can have executive powers in their hands. That was a big concession that Indians got. We can actually have governments, our own Indian Congress rule governments at provincial levels. But they also accepted the Muslim League demands. They created a separate Sindh. They created a separate Northwest Frontier Province. But the concept of reservation of population in provinces and one-third reservation at the central level, that was not accepted by the British for the time being. That was the only, you can say, thoughtful decision of the British. So till 1935, you will have that these demands of Muslims, partial demands, were being slowly, slowly fulfilled. Now the process of Pakistan really starts. In 1933, you had a student called Rehmat Ali who actually used the word Pakistan for the first time. But what exactly constituted Pakistan was not clear. So nobody really paid attention to it. But as I told you, in 1935, the act was passed. The Congress demanded Purna Swaraj or full independence since 1929. The Muslim League was wanting more and more concessions, and naturally the Hindu Mahasabha was acting as a counter. It was dead opposed to any concessions being given to Muslims. So be it Savarkar, N.C. Chatterjee, N.C. Kirkar, and in these decades we'll have Shyama Prasad Mukherjee rising. So you will have these people being steadfastly being opposed to the demands of the Muslim League. But 1935 Act was passed. So provincial elections were to be held now because it allowed provincial elections, direct elections, and Indians could form governments at the provincial level. So you will find that Elections were held in 11 provinces. After Northwest Frontier Province and Sindh were formed, you had 11 provinces in India, and elections were held there. Separate electorates were there for Muslims, but they did not have reserved seats, but they had separate electorates. And Congress fought it, Muslim League fought it, Hindu Mahasabha fought it, Ambedkar's own Peasant and Labour Party fought it. Multiple parties fought those elections at provincial levels. Despite having separate electorates, the Muslim League could not win considerable seats at all. So this will reflect the mood of the common Muslims in India, that despite the violence, there was hardly any support for the Muslim League and its own agenda for more and more concessions for the Muslims. The Congress Muslim candidates won from the separate electorates. So out of the 11 provinces, Congress won majority in 8 provinces, and it could form coalition government in another 2. So apart from one province, Congress formed the government everywhere. And you will find that so the Muslim League agenda was essentially defeated at its core because the people did not vote for it. So you will find that the Muslim League found itself at an existential crisis in 1937, that simply we had fought elections, but the Muslims did not vote for us. And the Congress formed the governments. So this boosted the confidence of Congress. The governments continued from 1937 to 1940. Why till 1940? Why did not it complete 5 years entirely? Is because Second World War was declared in 1939 and British pulled India into the war because India was a colony of the British. And this was thoroughly rejected by the Congress, and as a protest, the Congress ministries resigned in 1940. So you will have 1937 to 1940 is the time where the Congress actually gained executive power in the provinces of this country. So that was the first time when the Congress actually tasted power. Anushka, the act from 1929 was delayed till 1935. The core reason is civil disobedience movement. It continued from 1930 to 1934, and that stalled all the constitutional talks. Okay, so in 1937, you had the Muslim League being thoroughly defeated. The Congress formed the government. Now, Nehru himself started his Muslim mass contact program in 1937. So he wanted, he knew it, that the Muslim League is now trying to woo Muslims. So the Congress must woo the Muslims towards itself. So a Muslim mass contact program was started. But that mass contact program did not actually made the Muslims really pro-Congress. As I told you, the violence, multiple small violences, instances were still continuing throughout 1930s. So you will find that it is not that violence was stopping, especially in Punjab and Bengal. These were the two big provinces which were Muslim majority and where Pakistan was going to be formed sometime in the future. So in these provinces, you will find that maximum violence was happening. And side by side, the Muslim League was also getting defeated in elections. So you will find that it was a complex situation. You cannot clearly say that the Muslims of India wholeheartedly supported for a separate country, because the demand for Pakistan was never put up at the first place till 1937. What happened was that now Jinnah entered the third phase. The four phases that had talked in the start, now we are entered the third phase from 1937 till 1946. The third phase is called as a period of obstructionism, deliberate anti-Congress propaganda, deliberate communal propaganda, and deliberate instances of mobilizing the Muslims against the Hindus. These aspects were started by the Muslim League. Naturally, Jinnah was extremely saddened that he could not form government in any provinces. He was the main leader of the Muslim League. So what he did was that after 1937, he started to mobilize Muslims on many issues. So the best example that I can give is, we all heard that the triple talaq was declared unconstitutional. 2016-17 ki jo case thi, it was declared unconstitutional. But which law exactly was declared wrong? The law was the Shariat Application Act and the Dissolution of Muslim Marriages Act 1937. So the law, the personal law codification of Muslims happened in 1937, because it was the demand of the Muslim League that the personal laws of Muslims should be codified and given legal status. And he actually mobilized all the mullahs and maulanas of those time, and he asked them to support the Muslim League in this process. So what happened was that the membership of Muslim League skyrocketed multiple times in just 3-4 years. Till 1940, Muslim League became a major body representing Muslims, because Jinnah was started taking up Muslim issues in public forum. But intrigues were also going on. How? The British were totally silent. When it comes to Muslim issues, Muslims were totally supported by the British, and the Muslims ensured that you will have all the demands of the Congress, which can actually have an impact on Muslims being stonewalled by the British. What Jinnah did was that he set up a dubious commission. It was called as the Pirpur Commission. It was a princely state, Pirpur, and the Maharaja of Pirpur was the so-called chairman of that commission. And what was the purpose of that committee? It was to document the violence and discrimination against Muslims in Congress-ruled states. Because I told you, 1937 to 1940, the Congress was in power in almost 10 provinces out of 11. So you'll find that the Congress was being unduly targeted by the Muslim League. And this report, the Pirpur Committee report, was an absolute dubious report, a fake report. And you will have absolute fake stories being propagated by Muslim League just to have this victim narrative go in the minds of Muslims that see, if you support the Congress, they will discriminate against you. They will support the Hindu violence against you, and they will ensure that you are nowhere. So this actually resulted in more and more mobilization in the favor of Muslim League by 1940. And the major event or the watershed moment came on in March 1940. The Congress ministries were about to resign, so Jinnah celebrated it as a day of deliverance. So he was happy that the Congress went out of power, because now it opened up scope for Muslim League to again fight elections and get power. In March 1940, there is a location in Lahore called as the Shahidi Park. It is there even today. In that region, the Shahidi Park, the Muslim League was holding its annual session. So it had met there, the Muslim League leaders had met there in 1940 March. And they passed a resolution. Since 1906, they have passed hundreds of resolutions. But why is this resolution important? It is because in March 1940, the Muslim League resolution unanimously passed said that geographically continuous regions in northwest and northeast India having Muslim majority should be grouped together as autonomous provinces. I am again repeating, geographically continuous districts in the northwest and the northeast corner of India, that is, northwest means Punjab and northwest frontier province, and northeast means Bengal and Assam. These should be grouped together to form autonomous provinces. This is considered to be the famous Pakistan Resolution. So the Pakistan Resolution, the resolution did not mention the word Pakistan, but it put forth the demand of autonomous provinces in the northwest and the northeast region of India. So you will find that a formal process of demand for a separate country was put up by Jinnah. So by first they had separate electorates, then they had asked for reservations which they did not get, then they asked for separate provinces, then they got, then they knew that while fighting elections they are nowhere, then they started mobilizing people, and now they have put up a demand that all the Muslim majority regions in northwest and northeast of India should be grouped together as autonomous provinces. So this is considered to be the Pakistan Resolution. This is when the Muslim League officially now starts demanding for a separate country. And that is where you will find that the entire country is plunged into uncertainty. Now see how complex processes function. 1940, Muslim League is demanding for a separate country. In 1940, the Congress is more about mobilizing its people for a new movement. Remember, Quit India happened in 1942. So we are talking about that now. So Congress was into mobilizing people against the British. The British were bloody busy fighting the war because their country was under war. Hitler had totally ruined many places in Europe. Hitler had attacked Britain. The Air Force, the Luftwaffe of Hitler, had bombed London in 1941. So you will find that was a big headache for the British. Japan had entered the war, and through the Indo-Pacific, Southeast Asian regions, they had pulled back the British. And by 1942, you had Japan coming to the boundaries of India. It had captured Burma. It had bombed Sri Lanka, Visakhapatnam, and other regions. So there was a full-fledged possibility of Japan invading into India in 1942. So you understand the headache of the British was totally different. that they wanted to protect their own mother country and protect India, because India was very strategically important for them. If India was overrun by the people in the Second World War, it was very difficult. So the British had different priorities. The Congress was dead against the British, and it wanted to mobilize people against the British. And the Muslim League was now started to demand for a separate country, that is Pakistan. Hindu Mahasabha was naturally mobilizing in the opinion of Hindus against it. So you will find that the entire process of further constitutional reforms in India was stalled because of the Second World War. But now the British felt that kuch bhi ho jaye, we need support of the Indians for the cause of Second World War. We cannot afford to have unrest in India if we want Indians to wholeheartedly support the British in Second World War. So now starts the constitutional phase, as in the British are now slowly, slowly giving more and more concessions to the Indians. अभी तक क्या दिया था? They have said, okay, we have set up democracy, government at three levels, we have allowed direct elections at provincial levels, we have allowed you to form governments, Indian, fully Indian governments at the provincial level, we have allowed you representation at the central level. Now what remains? Though धीरे धीरे we are inching towards independence. Now what the British can slowly, slowly give you is nothing but more and more concessions, finally leading to independence. So in 1940, you have Lord Viceroy, Lord Linlithgow, the Viceroy of India, giving his August offer, because it was in the month of August. So August 1940 offer, he said that we are ready to give dominion status to India. What is dominion status? That Indians will form government in India, but the head of the state will be the Queen of England. Just like we have in Australia and Canada today, that those may be independent countries, but the head of the state is still the Queen of England. So they wanted dominion status for the for British said that okay, we'll give dominion status for the entire region for India. What happened was that the entire August offer was totally rejected by the Congress and everybody, because he said हमें पूर्ण स्वराज चाहिए. Why are you giving us dominion status? By 1942, the Congress had the Quit India movement. Naturally, it was a big movement, and that actually sealed the fate for the British also, that the British understood that you cannot hold on to India for long. Already you are suffering large losses in the Second World War, and now in India also there is unrest. Over the, and above that, the Muslims are demanding a separate country. So you will find that you will have no big action taken by the British apart from the fact that they are now giving more and more concessions to the Indians. So for the second time now, the British open up talks. In 1942, it's called as the Cripps Mission. It happened just before the Quit India movement. Sir Stafford Cripps was sent by Winston Churchill to India to hammer out a constitutional solution to India. What were the Indians demanding? They said, we want our constituent assembly at the central level, elected constituent assembly, which will be Indian majority, and the Indians will draft a new constitution for India. So this is like a stepping stone for independence. That was the demand of the Congress. Stafford Cripps said that, okay, let the war get over. After the war gets over, we will set up a constituent assembly. Majority will be Indians, and you can do with that process. You can continue with that process. But the interests of the Muslims will be taken care of by the British. So see, even the British now are supporting the Muslims. That interests of Muslims will be taken care, and till the time the constituent assembly does not frame a constitution, the Governor General of India, that is the Viceroy, will have overarching powers in all these issues. So the Congress felt that this is like a backdoor entry for the British, that while even we have power in Constituent Assembly, the British will continue to interfere in the affairs by this provision. So the Congress and majority parties rejected the Cripps offer. Same happened with Muslim League. Obstructionism is going on. It rejected the August offer. It rejected the Cripps Mission also. Now you will find that the violence in India is also increasing. 1933, 1943, 44, we'll have a lot of violence starting in Bengal and Punjab region specifically, because this is the place where Muslim League was now demanding Pakistan. So what was the demand for Pakistan? That entire Punjab and entire Bengal should go to Pakistan. That did not happen ultimately, but the original demand was entire Bengal, that is today's West Bengal and East Bengal, should go to Pakistan. An entire Punjab, that is today's Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Punjab, should also go to Pakistan. That was the original demand of the Muslim League. And they were now starting to mobilize Muslims on the ground. After the Congress ministries resigned from many places, the Muslim League somehow got hold of power in Bengal, in early 1940s, and there also you'll find more communal agenda being put forth by the Muslim League. So you'll find that communalization of India has now been fulfilled at the behest of Muslim League. Now slowly, slowly, the eyes of the Congress opened up, that now they realize that okay, that you will have a lot of problems in the entire country if really the Muslim demand is not fulfilled. The entire rhetoric of Gandhi of Hindu-Muslim unity, because he used to write a lot through his Young India and all these newspapers, he used to tour the country and give speeches. There he used to always espouse Hindu-Muslim unity and through his peculiar preachy and philosophical language. But then everything is now coming crashing down in front of them because there is too much of violence that is going on in India. And now the violence is just increasing. It is not subsiding. And now you have an entire community asking for a separate country. So you cannot ignore that demand. So what happened was that in 1944, Gandhi met Jinnah. He actually legitimized Jinnah as a leader of Muslims. When a big leader like Gandhi met Jinnah, he's legitimizing Jinnah as a leader of all the Muslims. But he met Jinnah in 1944 for the sake of saying that now the British are ready to talk with us. They are giving us more and more concessions. They want a constituent assembly to be formed. Why don't you support the Congress? Let us get independence and then we will see what to do with Pakistan. But those talks failed. You also have in those times C. Raj Gopalachari. He also had talked with Liaquat Ali Khan. He was a major leader of Muslim League then and the future Prime Minister of Pakistan. The Liaquat Ali and the C. Raj Gopalachari talks, they also failed. So you will have everywhere the Congress was now still hopeful that, okay, fine, Hindu-Muslim unity cannot be there, but somehow let's have a political compromise with the Muslims, Muslim League, ask for their support, let's get independence first, and then we'll see what to do with Pakistan. Nothing happened. Once again, the British Viceroy called the Indians for talks. This is when the World War II ended. In 1945, April, the World War II ended. In June 1945, the Viceroy of then Lord Wavell, he called for talks at Shimla. Hence, it is called as the Shimla Conference or the Wavell Talks. Congress, Muslim League, Hindu Mahasabha, all were there. You will find that Lord Wavell he went one step ahead in giving concessions. Now he said that the central ministries, that is Viceroy and his ministers, which were all British at that point of time, he said that except for Viceroy and the military, the commander-in-chief of armies in India, apart from these two people, rest all the ministers will be Indians. So it's like the Viceroy is giving you the charge of ministries at the central level. So this is next level concession that now you're getting charge of all the ministries, home affairs, finance, all these major ministry ka charge is now going to Indians. He said that whatever Indians will occupy those ministerial posts, 50% will be of Congress and 50 of Hindus and 50% will be of Muslims. So that was a sort of compromise that the British were giving, that khush raho, you are fighting Hindu-Muslim, aapko de diya ministerial posts, now at least ensure that you have 50-50 representation there. The Congress had its own objections, but again obstructionism of Muslim League, it said no. It said that 50% jo Muslim honge, they will only be representatives of Muslim League only. So the 50% Muslim ministers compulsorily have to be people from the Muslim League only. Viceroy Lord Wavell rejected this demand and the Wavell talks again failed. So you will have every time when there is some concession that the British are trying to give, every time the Muslim League will stonewall it, because the British are not ready to accept the demand for partition. So unless you accept our demand, we will not let any talks fulfill. And that is what was happening. And the final effort that was done by the British was in February 1946, when the government had changed in Britain. Winston Churchill had lost elections and Clement Attlee had become the Prime Minister. He was from the Labour Party, which was generally pro-India. They were pro-India in the sense that they wanted to give independence to India. So you will find that from 1943-44, it was clear that British had to leave India at some or the other point. It's about when. So as a final thing, Clement Attlee sent this cabinet mission to India and it had Stafford Cripps again, the Cripps mission wala of 1942 wale Stafford Cripps, he was again there, Sir V.A. Alexander and Sir Pethick Lawrence. These were the three people who were in that cabinet mission and they came to India to talk again with all the stakeholders that tell us what is to happen. There, the Congress said that we need united India, we need full independence, we need a power to have a constituent assembly. The constituent assembly should be elected by the Indians. Indians should be there in the constituent assembly and no European, and it should have the power to frame the constitution of India. Muslim League said we want Pakistan, the northwest and the northeastern regions, Sindh, northwest frontier province, entire Punjab, entire Bengal, and Assam. These five provinces were now being asked by the Muslim League for separate Pakistan. You will find that Pakistan demand was rejected by the cabinet mission. It said there can be no partition of India because one part of Pakistan will be there, one part of Pakistan will be here, and in between there will be India. It will be a stupid idea. But what it said was it gave concession that yes, there shall be constituent assembly formed in India at the central level. It should be an indirectly elected body, as in you will have elections in the 11 provinces. From there, indirectly, the representatives will be elected and sent to the constituent assembly at the central level, just like we have for Rajya Sabha, that there are MLAs of the different states and they elect among themselves and send people to Rajya Sabha. So similarly, a constituent assembly was to be indirectly elected by the elections held in provinces, and representatives of the princely states will also be there. And that constituent assembly will start framing the constitution of India. That was accepted by the cabinet mission. But naturally, it did not agree to the concept of partition of India. And that's why the Muslim League accepted, okay, that let's have elections at provincial levels, because now it had a chance of winning Muslim majority regions, because the country was totally polarized. So it had scope of winning Muslim majority regions. So the Muslim League accepted it, okay, let's have elections at the provincial level, but it rejected the broad idea of cabinet mission because it denied partition. So from the British side, they were clear that we are giving you so many concessions, and they deliberately let the talks fail because the Muslim side was unhappy. So the Muslims were being aided by the British to some extent. So now all the concessions that the British gave were almost over. Now it's like one step before independence. Now आपको कॉन्स्टिट्यूंट असेंबली भी मिल गई, आपका कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन का फ्रेमिंग चालू होगा अभी, एवरीथिंग इज देयर, दस इंडिपेंडेंस रिमेन्स नाउ. बट स्टिल यू विल हैव द मुस्लिम लीग एडमेंट इन दिस कंट्री, एंड दे सेड दैट नो, वी वॉन्ट पाकिस्तान एंड नथिंग लेस देन दैट. वायलेंस वॉज हैपनिंग एवरीवेयर इन द कंट्री, बट वेन द नेक्स्ट फेज स्टार्टेड इन 1946, आफ्टर मिड 1946, दैट इज द पीक ऑफ वायलेंस इन इंडिया. बिफोर गोइंग दैट, आई डिड नॉट मेंशन मच अबाउट द हिंदू महासभा. What was the Hindu Mahasabha doing in the 1940s? You will have Shyama Prasad Mukherjee emerging as the leader of Hindu Mahasabha from Bengal. I told you after 1940 you will have a Muslim League ministry in Bengal because the Congress ministry had resigned, and somehow the Muslim League had a coalition government with the other party. There was one another party called as the Krishak Praja Party, and from there Muslim League came to power in Bengal. It wreaked violence. There was separatism. There was separate provisions for Muslims. Muslims were given extra space in civil service in India, in the Bengal region. So you will have more and more Muslim communal politics happening in Bengal. Now Shyama Prasad Mukherjee was there. He started to realize that now things are getting difficult. We, as Hindu Mahasabha, it wanted Akhand Bharat, fair. It wanted the Hindu interest to be protected, fair. But by 1943-44, you will have the Hindu Mahasabha changing its entire viewpoint that yes, we want Akhand Bharat, but if there is so much violence, how on earth are you going to protect this country? How on earth can a united India function? Because within India itself, if the 30% population is not willing to live with you, what is the guarantee that after independence these people will not again wreak violence? What is the guarantee that these people will stay peaceful? So the Hindu Mahasabha now started to realize ये सही नहीं हो रहा. यू विल एक्चुअली फाइंड दैट द अर्लीस्ट डिमांड फॉर हैविंग पार्टीशन वॉज फ्रॉम द हिंदू महासभा. दैट फाइ आफ्टर 1940, मिड 1940, यू विल हैव श्यामा प्रसाद मुखर्जी ओपनली सेइंग दैट देर शुड बी अ पार्टीशन ऑफ पंजाब एंड बंगाल. इफ मुस्लिम लीग इज आस्किंग फॉर पंजाब एंड बंगाल, गिव इट टू देम, बट नॉट इन इट्स एंटायरिटी, बिकॉज इफ यू गिव एंटायर पंजाब एंड एंटायर बंगाल टू द मुस्लिम लीग फॉर पाकिस्तान, where will the Punjabi and Bengali Hindus go? Where will the Sikhs go? So Shyama Prasad Mukherjee was one of the earliest proponents of this theory that Punjab and Bengal should be partitioned into two, and so that there will be some place for the Bengali and Punjabi Hindus to live, and give the rest part to Pakistan. Because if you do not do that, there will be a civil war in India, and you simply cannot control that situation. As an independent country, we are already poor, and we will be poor after British leave, and we cannot afford so much of violence. So the earliest proponents of this theory of that, okay, let's give half of Punjab and Bengal to them, it was Shyama Prasad Mukherjee. It was a very wise and practical decision. On the contrary, the Congress was more of a utopian world. That still, you know, Gandhi was like, ha, Hindu-Muslim unity. The Congress was still in negotiation with Muslim League. I told you how Gandhi met Jinnah, how Raj Gopalachari met Liaquat Ali Khan. So they were still hopeful that we will be able to have some compromise with the Muslim League, and we may be able to keep India united, and we may hammer out some compromise by giving more and more concessions to the Muslims. So you can understand how the Congress was still not really ready to smell the coffee and what was happening in front of them. What was Ambedkar doing? Ambedkar wrote a brilliant book called Partition, Pakistan and the Partition of India. It was written in 1940. So you can imagine there were many violence of 1940 which was yet not happened. But there also Ambedkar says that it is good to have partition of India. It is better that Hindus and Muslims are two separate nations, and it is better to keep them separate. And it is always better to have, let's consolidate India, the rest of India, and make it into a strong country. Ambedkar gives very strong arguments for that. He says that even if the Congress and Gandhi are successful in convincing the Muslim League and having a united India after 1947 or whenever the British would leave, what is the guarantee that the Muslims will not stonewall government processes? Because the demand of Muslim League was, in the earliest days also, that whenever a law has to be passed in the parliament or at the state level, unless the majority members of the Muslim League accept it, the law will not be passed. Imagine if India had become independent with such a provision. Can India function from a government perspective? Can the government take decisive decisions? Would the government would have said, in case of Corona, had we been successful in creating a lockdown? Because some Muslim members would have objected to it. They said that, nahi, hame masjid jana hai, how can we have a lockdown? Can India had passed all the revolutionary great laws that we have passed in the last 70 years? Maybe no. Because this provision itself was so dangerous that if the majority Muslims don't agree to it, we will not pass that law. So he said that even if you are successful in having a separate united India and giving some concessions to the Muslims, those concessions will be so horrible that you will not be able, India as a country will not be able to function. He used the word national frustration. The cause of India would be frustrated if such a kind of arrangement is even worked out with Muslim League. So he said it's better you partition the country, you give them whatever they want, and consolidate the rest of India on modern lines. The second argument that he gave was, what is the guarantee that the Muslims in India will remain loyal to India? Logical question. It was not just theory, okay? This is not some rhetoric or some political propaganda going on. No. Ambedkar gave valid reasons. You may be not knowing, but there was an Afghan invasion of India in 1919. That is called as the Third Anglo-Afghan War. What was it? When the Khilafat mobilization was happening in India, the Amir of Afghanistan was poked by the Muslims of India into saying that you invade India from the northwest part, destroy the British, and let's make India independent. Even if that was the projected aim, the real aim was that they wanted the Mughal-like rule in Delhi again. After the British used to be defeated, the Amir of Afghanistan would come to India, and a Muslim rule will again be set up in India. That was the aim with which this invasion had happened in 1919. He said, what is the guarantee that after India becomes independent, there may be no other invasion? Secondly, there was always this talks going on for a Muslim federation in the world. From Turkey till Afghanistan, you will find that all the countries in between them are Muslim countries. There is not even a single non-Muslim country. Israel was not born till then. So all were Muslim countries. So there was a plan to create a Muslim federation. Ambedkar talks about it in his book, that there was a plan to create a Muslim federation where those nations will be independent, but they will act as a group to protect Muslim interests. He said, what is the guarantee that tomorrow the Amir of Afghanistan, supported by the armies of all of these nations, what is the guarantee that he will not invade into India? And when he does, What is the guarantee that the Indian Muslims will support India and not go and join them? Because the Muslim leaders themselves were in public forum saying that we will not fight our own brethren. So if they are Muslims, we will not fight them. So what is the guarantee that they will not join hands with them? So what he said was that after 1947, if India becomes independent, what is the guarantee that the Muslims in that country will protect India and not join hands with any other country? Supposedly tomorrow, if another colonial power wages war against India, British leave, but France says that we want to capture India and colonize it, which was a real possibility again. So if another colonial power comes into India, what is the guarantee that the Muslims of the country will not support it or support it? He gave statistics from the Army of India. So there was a census, caste and religion based census of British Army that used to be done. He gave a census and he concluded that at any given point of time, about 50 to 60% of the soldiers in the Indian Army were Muslims. Why? Because the British recruited Pathans and the Punjabi Muslims because they were more martial in nature, more than any other people. So you will have a natural majority of Muslims in the Indian Army at that point of time. And after the Second World War, when there was mass recruitment for the sake of fighting, naturally the Hindus were recruited more and so the majority reduced. But at any given point of time, there were a lot of Muslims in the Indian Army. He said, what is the guarantee that after 1947, these people, these Muslims in the Indian Army will fight in the favor of India and not go to the country that was invading us? So these were very, very logical reasons that were put forth by Ambedkar, and he said that you cannot compromise with the security of India. So it is better to partition the country. You give them a part of your revenue. All the Muslim battalions in the army, give it to them. Give them the land that they want and just consolidate the rest of India. He even supported complete population transfer for Punjab and Bengal. Not for the entire country, but for Punjab and Bengal, he said that it is good to have all the Muslims go into Pakistan and all the Hindus and Sikhs coming into the Indian part of that Punjab and Bengal. So he actually supported total population transfer there. So you can understand how practical he was in 1940s also. So these were the various stakeholders, what they thought. So you will find by 1946, the British wanted to leave India because already after 1945, they had faced a hell lot of damage because of Second World War. The Labour Party was in power. It was in favor of giving independence to India. So the British were simply just now oop chuke the. Now they just wanted to leave India. But they did not want any blame for any violence or civil war in India. The Hindu Mahasabha was clear ki kar do bhai partition, because that is the only option available. Ambedkar was supporting. The only party which was not in favor of all of this was Congress. It was still adamant that we can still have some compromise done with the Muslim League. So you will find that because of all of this, India was plunged into violence. So now we are talking of the fourth and the last phase of the partition story, that is violence. Remember, I told you that the cabinet mission in February 1946 said that you can have a constituent assembly fully of Indians and indirectly elected. So there will be elections first at the 11 provinces. From there, depending upon who wins how many seats, that much of percentage of members will be indirectly elected and they will go to the constituent assembly at the center. So in July 1946, provincial elections, all the 11 provinces went to election. Just like 1937, we had seen that in 1937 we had elections. So now in 1946 also we had elections. Again, the principle of separate electorates existed. The Congress, the Hindu Mahasabha, the Muslim League all fought elections. But this time, the Muslim League got 90% of all the reserved seats for Muslims. Imagine, in 1937, the Muslim League was nowhere. But in a matter of just 9 years, this country was so much communalized that the Muslims wholeheartedly voted for Muslim League. And Muslim League got almost 90% of all the votes that were meant for in the separate electorates. So you will find how the Muslims of India wholeheartedly supported the Muslim League in 1946. Bengal, Punjab, all these regions, naturally they were bound to support. But what about Madras or Bombay province? These were never going to be a part of Pakistan. But even in those separate electorates, in those provinces also, you will find the Muslim League winning. So the Muslims living in India, who were bound to live in India even after partition, still they voted for Muslim League on its demand of partition. That's a very interesting thing. So in elections in 1946, 11 provinces went for elections. Muslim League won majority in Bengal, wholehearted majority in Bengal. It won majority in Sindh. But the Congress won in Northwest Frontier Province, the Congress won in Assam, and in Punjab. The Muslim League did win majority seats, but the Congress prevented the Muslim League from forming a government by having a coalition with another Muslim leader called Khizr Hayat Khan. He was a unionist party. So Khizr Hayat Khan and the Congress somehow managed to form a coalition government and keep the Muslim League out of power. So out of those five provinces which were actually to go to Pakistan, Punjab, coalition government, and it kept Muslim League out of power. Sindh Muslim League, Bengal Muslim League, Northwest Frontier Province Congress, Assam Congress. So you will find that despite winning so many seats, somehow the Muslim League could gain power only in Bengal as a big province. So naturally from these provincial elections, depending upon how many seats you won, you have the indirect elections, and the Central Legislative Assembly or the Constituent Assembly was elected, and there also the Congress got majority. And this Constituent Assembly was to be treated as a body which will start drafting the Constitution of India. And based on who got majority in that Constituent Assembly, the first interim government in India was to be formed. So Congress won. So the Congress set up the first interim government of a national government in India. Jawaharlal Nehru became the first interim Prime Minister of India in July 1946. The Constitution also began to be framed after July 1946. So it's a big misconception. We think that India got independence in 47 and after that we started to frame Constitution. It's a wrong notion. Even before we got independence, since July 1946, you had the process of Constitution being started, because that body was the Constituent Assembly. It was bound to draft the Constitution of India. So now this interim government was there. Congress won the majority. But the Muslim League understood that if it takes part in the Constituent Assembly, it's of no use, because everywhere it is Hindu majority and Congress majority. There was no point. And all the thing that Muslim League had was a big majority in Bengal and no other major province except for Sindh. So now the Muslim League resorted to violence. We are actually now going to Bengal, because Bengal is where Muslim League has a majority. So this terrible communal person called H.S. Suhrawardi, Hussain Shahid Suhrawardi, Muslim League leader, was the chief minister of Bengal province. On 16th of August 1946, he called up a big meeting of Muslims from throughout the country, but mainly Bengal, to come to Calcutta for their demand for Pakistan as a separate country. So now the call was for direct action. So now we will not talk. We will not indulge in any talks, no constitutional reform, no constituent assembly. We will directly wreak violence, official violence, nothing more than violence. So the Muslims gathered on 16th of August 1946 in Calcutta, and somehow an impression was given that the police and the army will not stop you. You can start with the carnage. And the riots broke out in Calcutta. It is called as the Direct Action Day. You can go on the internet and search. You will find horrendous pictures of dead bodies lying on the streets, vultures eating them, people being killed, women being raped. People were pulled out of their houses and killed in Calcutta. The violence spread into other parts of Bengal. So entire Bengal province was now under siege of violence. So Dhaka, Pabna, Jeshore, Khulna, all these major regions of Bengal, these went into violence. There was a Hindu counter-reaction for that Direct Action Day also. And in the next 5-6 days, more than 10,000 people were killed, including Hindus and Muslims. It was a terrible violence, and that was the first indication that this country may plunge into a civil war, because an entire province is now burning into violence. British sacked Suhrawardi, and president's rule, or what today we call as the president's rule, was imposed in the Bengal province. But the violence did not stop. As a counter to that violence, after end 1946, violence started at a place called Naukhali in Bengal. So we all have heard this name, Naukhali massacre. So the Hindus there were totally brutally killed. Many were converted to Islam. Women were literally bartered away by men. If Hindu women were caught, just pick them up and just barter away to the Muslim men, they will be married off. Many women were endlessly raped, and when they were discovered, they were found pregnant. you will find that Hindu properties were totally confiscated in these regions. So you will find that tremendous violence now began in Bengal. Was Punjab silent? The answer is no. In Punjab also, tremendous violence started. In Northwest Frontier Province, you had the Hindus being whisked out. In Punjab also, you will have in Sialkot and all the surrounding Lahore and other regions, you will have violence starting. So you have actual Muslim League being actually killing people like anything, just for the sake of Pakistan. Lord Wavell, who was the viceroy at that point of time, somehow, we are in August 1946, violence happened in Bengal. In September, October 1946, Lord Wavell somehow convinced Jinnah that at least join the government, interim government, and we'll see what happens. Don't give up your claim for Pakistan, but at least join the government. So Jinnah joined the government, the Muslim League joined the government. Liaquat Ali Khan became the finance minister of India. Nehru was the prime minister of India. By February 1947, the situation was so bad because the Muslim League members did not coordinate with the government. They did not attend cabinet meetings. Liaquat Ali Khan was the finance minister, but he did not give money to other ministries. So it was again obstructionism. Muslim League was clear that we are not to let this interim government function. So by January, February 1947, the Congress ministers began complaining that Muslim League is not allowing the interim government to function. At that point of time also, you will have political uncertainty in Punjab. You will have the Muslim and the Hindu members having extreme heated debate in the Lahore Provincial Assembly and at Lahore. And when the Hindu members boycotted the assembly, you will have the Muslim members coming out, and tremendous violence started in Punjab, especially in the Rawalpindi district. This is about February, March 1947. And this guy, Khizr Hayat Khan, who was in coalition government, he resigned. So now there is no chief minister in Punjab, there is no chief minister in Bengal. And the police and the army are almost like the British are keeping them at a distance from this violence, because the British don't want to take any sides. So these two provinces, without a chief minister and without police, these two provinces plunge into violence, tremendous violence. And Rawalpindi, Lahore, Peshawar, and all these regions are under violence. Every day violence breaks out, every day there are killings. And naturally, now, even before independence is announced, Punjab and Bengal see a large-scale migration of Hindus into India. They are either whisked away or they have sold their properties, and now they are coming into India because they realize that we cannot live with the Muslims anymore. So now they are coming into India continuously. So now, finally, you will find that the Congress somehow was now coming to its senses that, okay, now this is dangerous. ये बहुत चल रहा है. दिस वायलेंस इज गोइंग टू प्लंज इंडिया इन टू अ सिविल वॉर. एंड नाउ द लास्ट स्पार्क वॉज गिवन बाय द ब्रिटिश. इन फेब्रुवरी 1947 द प्राइम मिनिस्टर वॉज क्लेमेंट एटली. ही गेव अ स्टेटमेंट ऑफ क्लेमेंट, इट इज कॉल्ड एज अ स्टेटमेंट ऑफ क्लेमेंट एटली. ही फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम डिक्लेयर्ड दैट इट इज द इंटेंशन ऑफ द ब्रिटिश टू लीव इंडिया. दैट फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम द ब्रिटिश आर नाउ सेइंग that officially we are planning to exit from India. The time of exit will be June 1948. We will exit India by June 1948. And it was kind of a pressure creating tactic that we are exiting India, so the Congress and the Muslim League should stop the violence, and jo settlement karna hai kar do, take the constitutional reforms from us and just let us go. We don't want to be responsible for the violence in India. So it was a kind of a pressure generating tactic that Clement Attlee declared that by June 48 we are going to leave India. And he replaced Lord Wavell and sent a new viceroy to India, Lord Mountbatten. So Lord Mountbatten's work was to quickly settle the issues between Congress and the Muslim League and other people, the Sikhs, the Hindu Mahasabha and everything, and quickly come out with a scheme for exit of British from India. That was the task of Lord Mountbatten in February 1947. So now, by February 1947, you had enough pressure being created on the Congress that violence ho raha hai, the British are also ready to leave. Now it is time you also come and accept the idea that, okay, there should be partition of India. The Congress did. In April 1947, you had Acharya Kriplani, who was the president of Congress. He made an official declaration that the Congress accepts partition of India. While whatever Gandhi may have said that partition will happen over my dead body and everything, everybody finally accepted that there has to be partition. So the Congress accepted that by in April 1947, that there should be partition of India. We are ready for the idea of Pakistan, but we will not give entire Punjab and entire Bengal. It should be partitioned because Punjabi and Bengali Hindus should also have a place to live. So it accepted the demands of the Hindu Mahasabha essentially. So by 1947 April, you had all the major stakeholders of this country accepting on one common thing. The Hindu Mahasabha said partition होना चाहिए, अंबेडकर said partition होना चाहिए, the Congress now accepted partition होना चाहिए, the Muslim League as it is wanted partition, and now the British are ready to leave India and they have accepted that okay, if all Indians want partition, we will give partition. So by April 1947, all the parties are on the same page now that we want partition of India. So in June 1947, Lord Mountbatten comes out with his Mountbatten Plan, which is the plan for partition of India. What is the plan? He says that the Hindu and the Muslim members of Punjab and Bengal Assembly will meet separately, alag alag baithenge, and even if one group passes a resolution that there shall be partition of that province, the partition will happen. Naturally, both the groups met immediately in July and they voted that Punjab and Bengal should be partitioned. The second thing in Mountbatten plan was that Sindh Assembly shall vote by majority to decide whether it wants to stay in India or Pakistan. Same goes with Northwest Frontier Province and same goes with Assam. Assam stayed with India, Northwest Frontier Province and Sindh Assembly voted in the favor of Pakistan. The third thing was there shall be a referendum done in the Sylhet province of Assam of whether it wants to join East Pakistan or stay in India. A referendum was done and those people voted to come into Pakistan, so it was joined to East Pakistan. The fourth provision was that all the princely states cannot stay independent. They either have to join into India and Pakistan. So by June 1947, the work of Sardar Patel begins. He is the Minister of States, princely states. So he now starts to convince the princely states, please join into India. And by the time we got independence, actually, apart from Kashmir, Junagadh, and Travancore, apart from these three and Hyderabad, of course, apart from these four or five recalcitrant problematic princely states, he had succeeded in joining all the major princely states into India. So that process started after June 1947. And the last bomb dropped by Mountbatten in that plan was that we will not leave India on June 1948, but we will leave India on 15th of August 1947. So he preponed the partition. Why? It was to create pressure on the Indians that the partition is just around the corner. It's better you start with the process. They vote for partition and just finish it. During this time, don't forget that there was tremendous violence continuously going on. Multan, Calcutta, Dhaka, Lahore, Rawalpindi, Peshawar, all these major town centers had tremendous violence. There was violence going on in Bombay, in Delhi, and all the other regions, surrounding regions also. There was continuous violence going on, and that's why Mountbatten felt that if I prepone the date for partition, I'll create pressure on Indians to quickly resolve the issue, vote for partition so that the British can leave India, or it is not our responsibility now if violence breaks out in India. So he declared that there shall be a boundary commission, because exact boundary to khichni padegi na. So for that, there shall be a boundary commission called as Radcliffe Commission. Sir Cyril Radcliffe was the head of it, and that commission will decide on exactly how which districts will stay in India and which districts will go to Pakistan. The principle was all the majority districts which had Hindu majority will come to India and the Muslim majority parts will go to Pakistan, and he drew that boundary. And finally, the process of partition was set in, and on 15th of August 1947, the British officially declared that India is independent and India shall stand partitioned. So the Government of India Act, or the Independence of India Act 1947, was officially passed by the British Parliament, and it granted dominion status, but for all practical purposes it was independence to India, and it gave powers to the Constituent Assembly, which was formed to deal with the future matters of India henceforth. So the partition happened, but the British did not leave like that. The reward of that boundary commission was not declared before 15th of August. So on 15th of August, we did not know what exact boundary India had. दैट अवार्ड केम ऑन 18th of August, सो दैट द ब्रिटिश वुड से दैट हम चले जाएंगे, वील गिव दैट अवार्ड टू यू एंड यू डिसाइड वॉट टू हैपन, बिकॉज दे न्यू, बिकॉज वंस द बाउंड्रीज आर परफेक्टली डन, यू विल हैव मूवमेंट ऑफ पीपल फ्रॉम हियर एंड देयर एंड दैट टू थ्रू वायलेंस. सो यू विल हैव ऑगस्ट से जो वायलेंस चालू हुआ, शेखुपुरा वायलेंस, निजामाबाद वायलेंस, द नौखाली राइट्स वर ऑलरेडी हैपनिंग, द ढाका राइट्स वर हैपनिंग, यू विल हैव पंजाब एंड बंगाली हिंदूज बीइंग किल्ड इन देयर रीजन्स, विस्ट अवे इन टू इंडिया. इन पंजाब यू हैव वॉच दैट इन द मूवी गदर, दैट ट्रेन्स आफ्टर ट्रेन्स आर अराइविंग विद डेड बॉडीज, हिंदूज एंड सिख्स आर बीइंग किल्ड एंड द डेड बॉडीज आर बीइंग सेंट टू इंडिया. दैट प्रोसेस ऑल्सो स्टार्टेड आफ्टर ऑगस्ट 1947, बट ऑन 15th of August 1947 इंडिया स्टूड पार्टीशन इन टू पाकिस्तान एंड इंडिया. एंड जस्ट सी हाउ द प्रोसेस स्टार्टेड, वी हैड बिगन विद अ सिंपल ग्रांटिंग ऑफ सेपरेट इलेक्टोरेट्स इन 1909, देन द डिमांड इंक्रीज फॉर मोर रिजर्वेशंस, मोर रिप्रेजेंटेशन, सेपरेट प्रोविंसेस, प्रोविंशियल ऑटोनॉमी, फाइटिंग ऑफ इलेक्शंस, मोर प्लेस इन सिविल सर्विसेज, एंड देन फाइनली वी नीड ऑटोनॉमस प्रोविंसेस इन इंडिया, एंड देन द फाइनल डिमांड वॉज पार्टीशन, वी नीड अ सेपरेट कंट्री. सो दैट इज हाउ द थिंग्स स्लोली स्लोली बिल्ट अप, एंड यू विल हैव अ मेजर ब्लेम बिंग पुट ऑन द कांग्रेस एंड द गांधी दैट दे रिमेंड इग्नोरेंट टू द फैक्ट दैट देर इज टू मच वायलेंस, एंड दैट्स वाई इंडिया हैड टू लेट गो ऑफ 40% ऑफ इट्स लैंड एंड वी क्रिएटेड अ सेपरेट कंट्री ऑन टू इट सेल्फ. सो दैट वॉज द स्टोरी ऑफ पार्टीशन ऑफ इंडिया. वी जनरली डोंट लिसन टू सो मच स्टोरीज बियॉन्ड 10th standard, सो इट आई थॉट इट वॉज अ गुड आइडिया टू रिकैप यू विथ ऑल दीज स्टोरीज. सो आई गेस आई हैव ऑलरेडी कंज्यूम्ड अ लॉट ऑफ टाइम, ऑलमोस्ट 1.5 hours. So if at all you have some questions or queries, you can just type it down and I will reply you by typing, just to save everybody's times. So I hope this entire thing was interesting for you. Thank you. Thank you very much.